sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you all hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees.
I'm pretty sure we have met. Never
single day of your life. I'm the whisper inside, won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again. You've lost all belief. These are the voices. These are the lies. I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, the one true King. Whoa, 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 whoa.
I am no longer defined by all the wreckage behind. The one who makes all things new has proven it's true. Just take a look at my life.
Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
Upon us that we should be called his children. I am the child of the one true King.
One love the Father is lavish upon us that we should be called his children. The song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
Good morning, Life Church. See, that's what happens when I close my eyes. I forget what word comes up next. But it's all good, ain't it? We're here to praise Jesus regardless whether I mess up or not. I'm going to read a passage of Scripture to you this morning out of Hebrews chapter 9. Beginning in verse 18, it says, "Therefore even the first covenant was not inaugurated without blood. For with every commandment had been spoken by Moses to all the people according to the law. He took the blood of the calves and the goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, 'This is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you.' And in the same way he sprinkled both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry with the blood. And almost all things are cleansed with blood according to the law. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Without the shedding of blood of Jesus Christ, there's no forgiveness." You know, and I like to make things personal. You know, everybody can pretty much quote John 3:16, that "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." But if we change that to "For God so loved Matt that he gave his only begotten son. The Lord loves us so much that he was willing to die on that cross for our sins. Without the shedding of his blood, there would be no forgiveness. So if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus, I say it every Sunday. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus, do not leave that way today. We're getting ready to sing a song called Thank You, Jesus, for the Blood. We were all lost at one time, but Jesus is there for us, always. And again, if you're here, you don't know him, this altar's always open. It never closes. If you come up and you need help, and Isaiah's busy, Travis is busy, I will put this guitar down, and I will come and help you. I'll help show you the way to Jesus Christ. Let's bow and have a word of prayer this morning. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we humbly bow in your presence, Lord, we just want to thank you for all the wonderful blessings you've given us. Lord, we just thank you for the shedding of that blood. Father, that through you, through relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ, Father, that we have an eternal home in heaven. Father, I pray for each and every single person that's here this morning. Lord, you know each and every single need that's going on. Lord, we just pray for healing where there needs to be healing and peace where there needs to be peace, Father. Lord, for the ones that are hurting, Lord, we just pray that you wrap your ever-loving arms around them and to just give them a peace that surpasses all understanding, Father, and just let them know that you are here. Your word tells us, Father, that when two or more are gathered together in your name, you'll be in their midst, Lord. Lord, we know you're here this morning. Lord, we just pray that the Holy Spirit start working. Lord, we just pray that we, as individuals, invite the Holy Spirit here to just praise your great name, Father. Lord, be with the service. Be with Brother Isaiah, giving the words you'd have him to say and hiding behind the cross, Father. We love you. We praise you. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen.
The blood of the Lamb. So thank you, Jesus. Glory to His name.
wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my relief. The sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my relief. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me.
be seated.
Romans chapter 1 helped me preach this sermon this morning, or at least introduce its title. I've had way too much caffeine and way too little sleep, but it is good to be out of Keno, and it is excellent to be out of the basement. Y'all pray for us. Even the dog got flu this week. Our dog had the flu. Romans chapter 1, touch your neighbor and tell him, don't buy, don't buy. Turn to your other neighbor and say, though I. We're going to jump right in. Romans chapter 1, we're going to start in verse 25. Staying with me is honor the reading of the Word of God. I think sometimes we become familiarized with what words mean, but sometimes you get a little more insight when you understand the meaning. And so I want to start with the definition of a lie this morning. A false statement made with deliberate intent to deceive or suppress an intentional truth. An inaccurate, incomplete, or untrue statement. Can we all agree that that's pretty much a lie, amen? All right, let's read Romans 1:25. Who exchanged the truth of God for the lie. Do you see it say amen? And worshipped and served the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for your love. Lord, your grace. Lord, for the deliverance and salvation that we sang about this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we pray that you would bless the reading and the preaching of it today. May it be your voice that's heard, not mine. And Lord, I pray that we would do business with you. Lord, bless this your church and bless the time we get to spend together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray and ask all these things. Amen. You may be seated. I want to run through a couple other verses because this is going to help us kind of build where it is that we're going today. And so the next verse that I'm going to read you is actually in reference to obviously Satan, but specifically the Antichrist. And so we're building on this subject matter of the lie. Now, I want to show you this passage is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9, but it offers the same verbiage. The coming of the lawless one, talking about Antichrist, will be in accordance with how Satan works. He will use all sorts of displays of power through signs and wonders that serve the lie. And so the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul told us, under the leadership of the Holy Spirit, that there is going to come a time when people will literally exchange the truth of God, and they will exchange it for the lie. And then the same Paul, writing to the church at Thessalonica, says that this is the spirit of Antichrist, is that it will make people serve the lie. Now look at 1 Thessalonians 2:7. For the mystery of the lawlessness is already at work. In other words, when Paul was writing about this, he's talking about a future event and a future character of the Antichrist. But he says, you need to understand this, that while you're waiting for Antichrist, you're awaiting the return of Christ, it hasn't happened yet, the rapture hasn't happened, but this is all going to happen. He says, you also need to understand this, the spirit of Antichrist, this lawlessness and the lies is already at work. And he says, don't serve the lie. Then you read this in 1 John 4:3. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. And so what the Bible is trying to convey to us is that Satan has his M.O. and that the Antichrist, the coming Antichrist, will come, obviously, but that the spirit of Antichrist, that lawlessness, and specifically the lying, is already at work in the world. And that was when the scripture was written. And so I want to start here. The lie, the liar, and the lie. Now, with the risk of sounding like Captain Obvious for a moment, every lie needs a source. Amen? It requires a liar. And this is exactly what the Bible describes Satan as, is that he is the source of lies. He is a liar. John 8:44. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. And so we talked about this, maybe it was just a couple of months ago. I actually used this text, John 8:44, when I preached a message on Satan. But specifically this morning, I don't want to just examine the fact that he is a liar, or the fact that he does lie, or the fact that this lying and lawless attitude and spirit is actually the spirit of Antichrist. What we're going to do a deep dive into this morning is the how. How does he accomplish this? How is he so successful in it? How is it that Satan, day in, day out, with his minions, sells the lie? Because the Bible doesn't just say a lie, it says the lie. It says anything that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, any spirit that does that, it's the spirit of Antichrist, it's a lie. And so with this, how is this accomplished? And I think that first and foremost, we have to go back to the definition of what a lie was. And it's not just an intentional misleading. It's not just a false statement. It is also, by definition of the word, it is anything that suppresses truth. And this is one of the ways, and one of the major ways, that Satan is so effective in what he does and how he does it, is that he suppresses truth. And I want to show you this passage, Romans chapter 1, verse 18. We're talking about suppressing truth. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth. Do you see that? Say amen. In unrighteousness. And so the Bible is actually conveying that there is a time, there is a way, there is a day that we will live in that truth will be suppressed. And I thought about that this week, and in studying some of these scriptures and poring over them, I thought, there is so much. We live in a society where there is so much information readily available if you desire it, but even if you don't, it's kind of just shoved down your throat. It's everywhere. And I thought, man, this is how Satan operates, is the way that he weaves his way into people's lives, through that of distraction. And if you think about it, I want you to think about for just a second, allow your mind to go here, all the information that your brain processes in any given day, in any given 15-minute window, or even an entire week, that's not really that important. And I mean, I'm not saying that it's not entertaining. I'm not even saying that it's not fun. I'm not saying it didn't make you. I'm just saying that in the grand scheme of level of importance, I'm talking about the things that you process, the information that you're given, the things that you spend your time on, and do the time that you spend doing, that if somebody told you, okay, Isaiah, you got 12 hours left on planet Earth, go. I don't know if I would watch that YouTube video somebody sent me. Amen, if you understand. He does this through distraction. You find yourself, and please nobody leave church today going, my goodness, man, he's saying that all this stuff is evil. But we spend our time talking about who won what ball game, what's going on in D.C., what the Kardashians did or didn't do, who sent what TikTok video. I was told this week that there's actually this, I didn't fact check this, so maybe some of y'all can give some clarity, that there is actually a dog with some kind of channel that's got several million followers. Maybe somebody can give me some more information about that, but I was just like, that's crazy to me. And I thought we do this through television, we do it through movies, and we do it through social media, and all this stuff that in the grand scheme of things, maybe we have allowed the truth of the Word of God to be suppressed and the fact that we don't even know it. And what I want you to understand this morning is this is Satan's goal. He doesn't want you to know what's in your Bible. He doesn't want you to know how accurate it is. Because the Word of God, according to its own testimony, is truth. And if Satan can elevate things that will not matter in eternity, things that may or may not even be true, he can spoon feed entertainment and distraction so that you will ignore the truth of the Word of God and place emphasis on all these other things, then he suppresses truth and he doesn't care what you spend your time on as long as it's not this. Thought about some things this week in this that Satan wouldn't want you to know. How many of you know the account out of the book of Joshua where the Israelites walk around Jericho's walls and the walls tumble down? Anybody ever heard that story? Golly, I'm a failure as a pastor. I'll preach on that next week. But he doesn't want you to know. You didn't probably see this on the news, that archaeologists have now uncovered the walls of Jericho and they can't explain what made them fall the way that they have. Did you see that on CNN last night? I wonder why. I mean, seriously, think about that with me for a moment. That's a pretty big archaeological. Why is that not a big deal? Let me take you to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 44. You don't got to turn there. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 28. And the Bible there, under the leadership of the Holy Spirit, the prophet Isaiah makes a proclamation, makes a prediction about a king, specifically a Persian king, who is going to rule and shepherd the people. And his name is going to be Cyrus. And his name is not only Cyrus, but he's going to be the guy that allows Israel to just walk off out of bondage and return back to Jerusalem. And you say, why are you telling us that? Because Isaiah made that proclamation and prediction 100 years before Cyrus was born. How is that not a thing? Why isn't that in the news? Everybody okay? All right, I'm going to have fun. And I'm going to try to drag this out as long as I can. I'm kidding. You know, I thought about Job chapter 40. This is a common question I get as a pastor. It's like, why aren't there dinosaurs in the Bible? There are. In Job chapter 40, you read about this creature named Behemoth. I want to read you the description of, and you can be the judge. This is Isaiah chapter 40. This is the description, 15 through 24, of what this creature is. Now, the term dinosaur wasn't invented until almost 1900, and the Bible was completed a long time before that. So the reason the word dinosaur doesn't appear in the Bible is because of that reason. But here's how the Bible describes Behemoth, and you can be the judge of what this creature is. He has a huge, massive, and very strong stomach muscles. When this creature swings its tail, it's like an entire cedar tree is being swung. His bones are massive, like tombs of columns of bronze. His limbs like big rods of iron. So massive is this creature that it can step down into a raging river and not be bothered, alarmed, or even pestered. I came across one commentator. It was like, well, the Bible is describing a hippo here. It's like, when I think of a hippo, that's what I think of. A massive tail. And the reason that I tell you this stuff is that the Bible is littered with this stuff. Wednesday night, I taught on this too. I want to give you this. 2 Chronicles 32, 2 Kings 20, 20. The Bible describes this king that ruled over Israel. His name was Hezekiah. And at one point in time, they knew that the city was going to be besieged. So the Bible says that Hezekiah dug this specific tunnel out of the Gihon, which was the major water source in Israel. Gihon meaning gusher. And it was the water source for that entire town. And that Hezekiah dug this tunnel. And that way his people could have water and for years. And then they found it. And it was dug to the exact specifications that the Bible said that it was. How many of you knew about that? Raise your hand this morning. A handful. How many of you know who won the primaries? Raise your hand. How many of you know who won the UK game? How many of you know that tonight is the season finale of Walking Dead? Why do we not know this? Why is it that somebody's not talking about how accurate that the Bible is and all these different even biblical prophecies? The fact that Micah the prophet bore out that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem 535 years before he was. The fact that Zechariah says he's going to be betrayed for 30 pieces of silver and then he was. Why? The fact that the Bible predicts that Jesus would be crucified through means of execution that hadn't even been invented yet, nor had the nation Rome that would invent this means of execution had even come to power yet. Or that Jesus would say from the cross 1,000 years before he was born, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why is it that we don't know that? Why is it that you're not hearing that? It's because Satan doesn't want you to know. He wants to suppress the truth. Because God gave us a mind to think, and if your mind begins to tell you, my goodness, if the Bible's right about Hezekiah's tunnel and which direction the wind blows and what language they spoke where and the location of Jacob's well and the walls of Jericho, if all of these things are right, then the Bible is true. And then that would mean that the God of the Bible is true. And if the facts of the Bible are real, then the God of the Bible is real. And that would mean that there is a heaven to gain. There is a hell to shun. There is sin and righteousness. That would mean that if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, that I'll be saved. But if I reject it, I'm still in the dead in trespasses and sins. That would mean that too. It would mean that there's accountability. It would mean that there's standards. It would mean that there's truth. And he can't have you knowing that. And so he suppresses the truth. And he elevates the lie. It's not true. It's just stories. It's a book. It's peddled by religious zealots and people who are crazy. Can't be true. So that's the first thing that he does, is he suppresses truth. But then that makes this much more effective, and he does this with believers and non-believers, is the lies that he throws out. Lie number one, no one cares. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but how many of you have been going through something and just felt like, A, no one cares. B, nobody understands. No one cares. Here's the truth. That's not even true of people, I've found. And most oftentimes, especially if you're a believer and you've got some people around you, if you will just kind of tell them what's going on in your life and you will express a need, but it's hard to meet the needs of expectations that go unspoken. And here's the thing, just like you're not a mind reader, nobody else is. And if you don't put it out there, people don't know. Therefore, they can't pray. Therefore, they can't help. But all the while you're going through all that stuff, Satan's telling you, they don't care. And it's not true. But here is what is truth. Even if the former weren't true, God does. As a matter of fact, God cares for you so much that this is what the truth of his word says, that he calls you child. That he knows how many hairs are on your very head. that he cares for you so much and loves you so much. He says, I take care of the sparrows. I make sure that they're fed. I make sure that even the birds are provided for. How much more than, he says, you're of more value than many sparrows. Cares for you, loves you so much that he sent his only begotten son to die for you. He says, my yoke is easy. My burden is light. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Come unto the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. I love and care for you so much. There's an open invitation, Isaiah. You can come anytime. I thought, man, that'd make a pretty cool bumper sticker, wouldn't it? I care, quotations, hyphen God. I care, God says. It's not truth, it's a lie. The second lie, I think, is I can't. Philippians 4:13 actually begs to differ. It says, I can through Christ who gives me strength. Can what? Do all things? So I've talked to people that say, I can't quit. Yes, you can. I can't stop. Yes, you can. I can't do it. Yes, you can. Because God doesn't operate in lies. He operates in truth. And the truth of the Word of God says that you can. The other one that I think that he uses oftentimes is I'm not qualified. Now, I'm going to throw this out there, and I really don't like cliche preaching, but this is one of those things you've probably heard before. God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. So you've heard that too. And this is truth. If God has gifted you with it, and God has called you to do it, then it makes you qualified because he is the qualifier. Now, here's where I think that we get this most oftentimes. And this is when I see this oftentimes, this is in the aspect that it comes across my desk. Number one, in the church, it's like, I can't do that. I don't know. Like, yes, you can. And yes, you are qualified. Because if you are born again, if you are saved, then God is expecting you to serve, to use your gifts, to use your talents. Yes, you can. And because he's calling, that means you're qualified. As I preached last week, God's looking for a vessel that he can fill. If yours is empty and clean and he can fill you, then yes, that makes you qualified. All you have to be willing to say is, yes, Lord, use me. Here am I. Send me. I will go. That's it. But the other way is usually in the family dynamic. And this is how Satan operates. This is one of the lies. Is that he'll come to you and he'll say, Isaiah, you don't know how to deal with that. And before I know it, I'm like, I don't know how to deal with this. Anybody else in here, parents? It'd be a whole lot easier if kids came with instructions like the game Monopoly does, doesn't it? Or one of those little Lego sets that has like 4 billion pieces. But they don't. And Satan has a way of telling you, hey, you're not qualified to raise those kids, and you don't know what you're doing. And here's the truth of the matter is, I'm the father of four, and I really don't know what I'm doing. That's the reason I consult this book to make sure that I'm doing it the way God says, because he knows what he's doing. But here's the other side of the coin. Of all the people and parents on planet Earth, that God could have given Micah, Stephen, April, David, Lily, Grace, and Ezra, Jude to, he chose me and Brandy. And that means we're qualified. But you know what? He didn't give us your kids. He gave them to you. He said, Isaiah, you're going too far down that rabbit hole. You're going, no, I'm not. You know what God says? He says, when you were in your mother's womb, I knew you. And so that means you're qualified more than any anybody else on planet Earth to raise those babies and instruct those kids to be good to that spouse, because it wasn't by accident. It's a gift of God, and He chose you. 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 To parent those kids. To be that husband. To be that wife. To be mom. To be dad. And anything else is, well, it's just a lie. Then I have to preach this. And this one, if it's not for anybody else in the house today, it's for me. What if? What if? Anybody play what if? So this is for me and all the other what ifers in the house. You say, what's a what ifer? I'm talking about your mind just goes into places and down rabbit holes that, and see, somebody told me the other day, like, you're quick on your feet. It's because my mind never stops going, just runs all the time. But this can also be a curse. And it's a curse for me because I play the what if game. And this is one of my what ifs. It's like, what if I'm so transparent with my church that one day they walk out of there going, that guy's nuts. What if? What if? Well, what if I fall down? What if I drop the mic? What if they don't like the sermon? What if I got a booger hanging on my nose? I used to think, what if I bent over and my pants ripped, and then that actually happened, and you all made sure that sermon got thousands of views. Thank you. But now here's a what if that I had this week. Some of you all know Abel's still having some issues with neurology, so I had to take Abel to physical therapy, and Brandy had the other kids, and she took them to school, and Micah was kind of on the mend, so I thought, you know, Micah's good. He was still coughing a little bit, but he was home from school, and so me and Abel head off to physical therapy, but I also needed to stop by here and get my laptop because I had forgot it here Wednesday night, and I started playing the what if game. And I thought, you know what, I'm just gonna call and I'm gonna check on Micah. But Micah didn't answer. And Abel's like, what do you think he's doing? I'm like, I don't know. I'm sure he's fine. But just in case, we'll call him again. And I called him a second time and he didn't answer. And I called him a third time and he didn't answer. And I called him a fourth time and he didn't answer. And so I told Abel, I'm like, text him. I'm gonna text him. I texted Brandy and I had her text him. And then I texted Brandy and I had Brandy call him. And then my mind started going down the rabbit hole. What if he's in the basement and I left those Jolly Ranchers down there, and I know he might have a Jolly Rancher. Maybe he got choked and maybe he had a cough drop. Maybe he sucked the cough drop down his window. And what if he's choking? What if he went upstairs and tried to make him some breakfast and he left the burner on? And what if he burned the house down? And what if? What if that test doesn't come back good? What is that not? What if something bad happens? What if something worse happens? What if my kids never get well? What if we just have the flu in the super household forever? What if? What if this isn't really the flu, but some kind of super weird, toxic, mega strain? What if? What if this is that new thing of RSV that's shutting down the world that I read an article about just last night? What if it's that? What if? If you're a what if person, can I show you you're in good company? I want to show you this passage of Scripture. God really spoke to me through this. Exodus chapter 4, we pick up just after Moses has had the burning bush experience. God's just literally appeared to him in a burning bush. Moses, this is Exodus 4 verse 1. Moses answered, it's right there. It's like, on one hand, I want to kind of poke fun at Moses. Like, bro, you just had the burning bush, the God. Take off your shoes from the place you're standing on, it's holy ground, and, you know, the rod and the commission to go declare my people. And God even gave you his name, I am that I am. And you got to be the guy that God revealed that to. And Moses answered all that with, what if? What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord didn't appear to you? What if? I want to show you God's response. Next verse, Exodus 4:2. Then the Lord said to him, what is? Do you see that? God doesn't care about the what if as much as he cares about the what is. Because the enemy operates in what if. The enemy tries to get me to think so much about what if that I forget about what is. I'm thinking so much about what if that I forget what and who God is. God says to Moses in this moment, the very thing that you're holding in your hand is the very thing that I'm going to use. I don't need you to focus on what if. I only need you to focus on what is. It's lies versus truth. Let me show you one more verse. Pilate had the same question. John 18:38. This is Jesus, hours before his crucifixion. He's talking to Pilate. Pilate said to him, what is truth? It's funny and ironic because he's talking to the truth. And he's asking, what is truth? But I came to preach to you today, again, don't buy the lie. The truth is, we need Jesus. The truth is, you need Jesus. The truth is, the Word of God is true. And the truth is that you're not here by accident or happenstance or coincidence. That God has set aside this moment, this right now, as an opportunity for you to respond. And the truth is, whatever need that you came in here with, whatever burden you brought with you today, you don't have to leave with. The truth is, God's given you an opportunity, and I hope that you'll seize it right now. And let today be the day that you give your heart and your life to Jesus. I hope that today is the day that you recognize you don't have to play what if. I hope today is the day that you stop buying the lie. Whatever your need is, you come. Let's pray together. Stand. Father God, thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you that you don't operate in deception or lies, but rather in truth. And Lord, because your word is true, we can trust it. Lord, help us claim the promises of it this morning. Lord, speak as only you can. Lord, I pray that if there's one here today that's lost, that they wouldn't buy the lie, that they'd come to the saving knowledge of truth. We love you. We thank you for all you do for us. We thank you most of all for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed but not forsaken, I've been set free, I've been set free. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet. and you set your treasure in jars of clay. And so take this heart, Lord, and I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And I once was lost, but
for being here this morning. Thank you for your attention. Hey, listen, if you want to, I'd love to meet you. If we haven't got a chance to meet yet, please come back to the life table back here to my left, your right. Be glad to meet you. Be a privilege. If you want more information about the church, be glad to provide it for you there. But also, if you need prayer, you need to pray about something, you can come up here and see Travis, Matt. I'll be back at the life table. Interested in joining the church, anything like that. Would like to meet with you back there. Hey, tell somebody about Jesus this week and invite somebody to come to church with you next week. Let's pray this morning and be dismissed. Father God, we love you. We thank you for all you do for us. Lord, we thank you for just another opportunity to gather. And Lord, we ask now that you would just bless as only you can. And Lord, continue to add to this your church the way that you see fit. Lord, give us eyes to see and ears to hear the needs
that surround us this week. And Lord, we pray that you go before us, bless every home and every marriage that make it up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, but I was running out of time. Oh, when sin separated, the bridge was far too wide. But from the far